His chief characteristic was singleness of purpose. His idea of happiness was to fight, and his idea of misery was submission. His favorite occupation was bookworming, and his favorite poets were Shakespeare, Aeschylus, and Goethe. His favorite heroes were the rebel slave leader Spartacus and the astronomer Kepler. His favorite names were Laura and Jenny, and his favorite dish was fish. His favorite motto was, "You must have doubts about everything," and his favorite color was red. Karl Marx died 100 years ago, yet his specter continues to haunt our world. Though his body is safely buried in Highgate Cemetery, his ideas refuse to lie down and die quietly beside him. Those ideas have shaped our world more profoundly than Darwin, Freud, or Einstein. They've inspired men and women to fight and die for them, to overthrow old nations and construct new ones. And yet in Britain, where he spent the most productive years of his life, people know relatively little about him, apart from that grim, imposing monument in Highgate Cemetery with its gigantic beard, which has come to be a sort of symbol for what people think of as Marx or Marxism.
14 years I've been coming here now, and my main objective is to endeavor to keep this grave as tidy and as clean as possible. No matter what the weather, whether it's rain, sunshine or snow, there's always someone visiting the grave of Marx, and they come from all parts of the world. I feel it's a rather beautiful monument myself. It's like the philosophy of Marx, I think, so strong. Many, many English people visit here like other people, but they know very little about him. But after leaving this cemetery, they've had their first lesson in Marxism after reading the slogan there. The philosophers have only interpreted the world in various ways. The point, however, is to change it. That's just as important today as it was when it was written.
The words written on Marx's monument are important today because his philosophy has changed the world. From the Soviet Revolution of 1917 to the present day, a third of the world's population, 1,500,000 people in over 30 countries, have come to live in societies claiming inspiration from the ideas of Karl Marx. His revolutionary ideas of class struggle have inspired a chain of revolutions throughout the world. But the Marxist states that have resulted have sometimes been a long way from Marx's original ideas. Even the forbidding monument to Marx in Highgate Cemetery is not in fact where he was originally buried. His original grave lies 100 yards away, marked by a plain stone slab. And the contrast between these two graves is like the gap between what Marx was and what he's become, between Marx himself
and the long tradition called Marxism. I have never seen a man whose bearing was so provoking and intolerable. He was domineering, impetuous, passionate, full of boundless self-confidence. Vain, treacherous, and morose, a powerful, shaggy, untamed old man. These are some of the ways that Marx's contemporaries described him. Marx was a German Jew, studied philosophy and law, married a minor aristocrat, was forced by his political activities to move from Germany to France to Belgium, finally to Britain, where Prussian police spied his life. Marx lived first, therefore, one of the cheapest quarters of London. In the whole apartment, there is not one clean and solid piece of furniture. In private life, he's a totally cynical human being and a bad host. He leads a real gypsy existence. Washing, grooming, and changing his linen are things he does rarely, and he's often drunk. Though he's often idle for days on end, he will work day and night with tireless endurance when he has a great deal of work to do. Much of Marx's work was done in the British Museum, using this vast library to research and write a complex, far-reaching, interconnected series of books, pamphlets, articles, and manifestos. They're aimed not so much at a moral protest at the evils of capitalism, as at a cool, dispassionate analysis of how capitalism actually works, how it came about, and how it can be changed. For this reason, his key theoretical work is called, not as you might expect, Socialism, but Capital. It's a book that the Russian censors pronounced so boring that they let it through, but it's no museum piece. Hidden within its sometimes forbidding prose is the promise of revolution. It was a starting point for a chain of ideas that have inspired a world movement. Workers of all lands unite, you have nothing to lose but your chains, Marx wrote in the Communist Manifesto. These are the industrial working class to whom Marx addressed himself. His writing was aimed at their emancipation. It was rooted in the material reality of their lives. Marx began by examining human labor. The exercise of labor power, labor, is the worker's own life activity, and this life activity he sells to another person in order to secure the necessary means of subsistence. He works in order to live. For Marx, the capitalist hired the worker's labor power in order to extract a surplus from it. And there was a built-in conflict between the workers and the capitalist who exploited them, a class struggle. Nothing new, he wrote, because one fact is common to all past ages, the exploitation of one class by another. The key thing about any society was who provided labor power, who owned the means of production, and how this relationship was organized. In capitalism, for instance, the workers don't own the factories, the means of production, so they must sell their labor as a commodity to those who do, who extract a surplus from their labor. In the same way, in feudal society, the serfs were tied to the land and obliged to hand over a part of what they produced to the lord of the manor. And in slave society, the slaves themselves were physically owned by their masters, who also owned what they produced with their labor. For Marx, the difference between capitalism and previous systems was its phenomenal productiveness and dynamism. Marx believed that the pumping out of surplus from the workers' labor power gave capitalism its revolutionary force, allowing it to reinvest the surplus and expand, harnessing the new technologies of the industrial age, shattering older ways of organizing society, drawing men, women, and children from off the land into the new forms of factory production. Capitalism adapted workers to the disciplines of factory labor, fixing them in their place. In Marx's words, it transformed the living worker into a mere living accessory of the machine. In so doing, capitalism had produced a new kind of human being, the industrial worker, the proletariat. For Marx, workers were alienated or separated from both the products of their labor and from the surplus expropriated by the capitalist. Their working lives were fragmented by the division of labor. They were split off from other workers through competition. They had lost a sense of being at home in the world they themselves had created. Instead, their lives were overshadowed by the alien force of capital, feeding off their living labor. Marx wrote, "Capital is dead labor that vampire-like lives only by sucking living labor, and lives the more labor it sucks." And yet he believed capitalism was to be its own gravedigger. Behind the dynamism and productiveness of capitalism, Marx saw the appalling conditions it offered to working men and women, living cramped in overcrowded tenements with open sewers, crippled by hunger, illness, and debt, and by the constant fear of unemployment, slumps, and crises of capitalism. Marx believed that the experience of capitalism would begin to unify the proletariat as a class. He wrote, "With the development of industry, the proletariat not only increases in number, it becomes concentrated in greater masses. Its strength grows, and it feels that strength more." Marx believed that the workers would increasingly abandon attempts at compromise and reform. They would challenge the capitalist system through trade unions and political parties. These industrial and political struggles would produce a class-conscious labor movement that would finally overthrow capitalism. Marx rooted his analysis in the realities of 19th-century industry, partly learned from his friend Engels, a mill owner in Manchester, then the hub of world production. Marx made no claim that his analysis would be good for all time. So what relevance does it have 100 years later? What stands on the site of Engels's original factory? What kind of capitalism remains? Well, for a start, not much, because recession has struck here as elsewhere. Capitalism seems to have disappeared, though not quite in the way Marx imagined. But in one corner of the factory, it's a different story. A thriving young business manufactures high-tech microchip control systems for the leisure industry. Its managing director is 22 years old.
I don't know really how Marx would see us now. I suppose by the definition of capitalism, yes, I'm a capitalist. I'd like to think that I'm not the same sort of capitalist that used to be here in the time of Marx. I think capitalism still exists. Obviously it's got to if people are going to work, produce things, make a profit and create jobs. However, I think the overall face of it has changed an awful lot. Nowadays there's much more cooperation between myself and the people working here. The product that we're manufacturing the most of at the moment is the snooker light. It goes into a snooker club and monitors the actual table usage. We've installed them in snooker clubs all over the country.
It's an irony that Marx might have cherished that down in London, where Mike Newton's electronic control systems monitor the snooker tables, one young unemployed player sees the system through very different eyes.
When you first become unemployed, you start off and you think to yourself, it'll only take 2 or 3 weeks until I find a position and I should be all right, you know? Then a week, months, you know? And it just really is soul-destroying. I get, what, £22 a week, you know? I'd like to see Maggie Thatcher live for £22 a week, I really would. You just get deeper and deeper in debt. There's no way in the world that you can live on £22 a week, you know? Like, you can't eat properly, you only eat once a day, and even then only very cheap foods. When you get bills come in, you have to phone the people up or go to see the people, you know, sort of like cap in hand, you know, all the time. Same as what it was 100 years ago. We're going backwards, you know, instead of forward, we're going backwards. Same old thing, you know, that the rich man in his castle and the poor man at his gates. The system, the capitalist system, doesn't give us anything, really, you know. They're just, all they're interested in is just making as much money as possible, you know, and, like, fuck the rights of the workers. You know, they haven't got any rights as far as they're concerned. If a boss is generous enough to offer you a job, that's it as far as he's concerned, then he's God, you know, and you must look up to him and do everything you possibly can to keep it, you know, because he knows full well that if you don't toe the line, he'll just sling you out and get somebody else. You know, you're always conscious of that fact.
A century after Marx's death, the image of workers as the raw material for the industrial sausage machine may seem to many people a bit far-fetched. Marx would have been the first to see that in the journey from the 19th century to the present day, capitalism has changed profoundly. Some have even claimed that class divisions, and therefore class struggle, have ceased to exist. Of course, today's working class looks a great deal different from the 19th century sepia prints, as it hurries to the office or the factory of modern capitalism. It's no longer the top hat and the cloth cap that describes capitalism, nor even its modern equivalent, the bowler hat and the hard hat. Today's proletariat works in a range of industries that didn't exist a century ago. It includes more women workers, more black workers, more workers in the office and service sectors, more public employees, fewer in manufacturing. The modern working class is divided in all these different ways. And yet, it still sells its labor for wages, and its labor still produces profits, at least that's the intention. And people still experience, even with 3 million unemployed, the feeling that work is not the center of their creative lives.
Well, it's just a job, really, you know.
You do your job, but I wouldn't say it was interest. You don't choose it as a career. It's just something that you take up.
Obviously, I need the money, so it does play an important part, doesn't it, really?
You need money anyway, then you go to work.
You've got to come to work and earn some money to do what you want to do at home and enjoy yourself, haven't you?
Many people will recognise the sense of release at the end of the working day. Marx had written, "The worker only feels at home outside his work, and in his work he feels a stranger. He is at home when he is not working, and when he works he is not at home." Marx also pointed to the way workers become split off from the products of their labour, which stare back at them from the shelves of shops, stores and supermarkets as if they were alien objects. He wrote, "There is a definite social relation between men that assumes in their eyes the fantastic form of a relation between things. This I call the fetishism, which attaches itself to the products of labour so soon as they are produced as commodities." Marx anticipated the consumer society. In the language of consumption, objects take on a kind of magical significance of their own. We are the products of a new consciousness industry, buying not just goods but identities. Money becomes the universal language of human relations. Fundamentally, the capitalism that Marx wrote about a century ago remains intact. Capital still commands the forces of production. It harnesses and hires labor power. It secures the raw materials for production. It develops and implements new technologies. It reaches out to ever-expanding world markets, maximizing profits, knocking out competitors, centralizing on a world scale. The capitalism we face today links London, New York, Tokyo into a concentrated, integrated world system. Today, we live in a world of international banks, where finance capital coordinates the running of the international economy. The banks are interlinked with international corporations that employ an international workforce. They operate through international trade and transportation. They communicate through international data systems. Marx wrote, "The bourgeoisie has subjected the country to the rule of the towns. From the corporate headquarters in the great cities, they direct the modern world. They invest internationally, splitting up work between factories in different countries, linking the world through what Marx called a new and international division of labor, drawing in a new third world workforce at lower wages to yield higher profits, the most exploited sector of modern industrial capitalism." This third world workforce, fresh to the discipline of the factory, operates 20th century technology in return for wages and conditions which hark back to the 19th century.
The working condition here is very bad because we work 16 hours a day.
They are forcing us to have overtime all the day. We have 6 to 6, sometimes 6 to 8.
Yes, really, it's hard because they give us compulsory overtime.
Sometimes there are collapse, but nobody can go out because the door is locked, padlock, and the window is closed. Nobody can go home to their place.
For third world workers, life under capitalism seems similar to the conditions described by Marx's collaborator Engels, when he wrote, "A horde of ragged women and children swarm about here, as filthy as the swine that thrive upon the garbage heaps and in the puddles." It's the usual catalogue of poverty, hunger, disease, poor sanitation, high infant mortality. A century after Marx's death, capitalism has certainly changed and yet not changed. It's still a system which Marx would recognize and in which we recognize him. But Marx also thought of capitalism as its own gravedigger. How did that idea stand the test of time?
For Marx, capitalism bore within it the seeds of revolution. He expected this to begin in Europe, where capitalism was most advanced, and to become a world process as it progressed. The nearest he came to this in his own lifetime was with the uprising of the French workers against the state in 1871 and the formation of what has come to be known as the Paris Commune.
The Commune began when French workers took the opportunity of a war between France and Germany to undertake the first proletarian revolution. Marx, who was commonly seen as an enemy of democracy, admired the Commune because it tried to set up a decentralized federal system of direct democracy, where, as Engels put it, all officials, high or low, were paid only the wages received by other workers, and they were subject to election and recall at short notice. The communards had toppled the existing state machinery, which they saw as organizing society to serve the interests of capitalism. In place of the dictatorship of the bourgeoisie, they installed what Marx and others called the dictatorship of the proletariat. For the communards, this dictatorship meant genuine popular power. They attempted to defend the common ownership and control of the productive forces, to build a society where, in Marx's words, the free development of each is the condition for the free development of all. It was an experiment that couldn't be allowed to succeed. French and Prussian rulers joined forces to destroy the Commune. The forces of order besieged Paris to stamp out this short-lived experiment. Over 20,000 communards were killed. During the half century between the Paris Commune and the end of the First World War, Marxist ideas became a powerful force throughout Europe. And just as the chaos of the Franco-Prussian War had helped bring about the Paris Commune, so the colossal slaughter and incompetence of the First World War helped to produce the right conditions for the overthrow of the Tsar Nicholas II. The Bolsheviks seized power in the first successful revolution, claiming inspiration from Marx's ideas. Under conditions of severe Tsarist repression, the Bolsheviks had forged a tightly disciplined, centralized, secretive revolutionary party which spread Marx's ideas throughout the Russian workers' movement. Their leader was Lenin, and like Marx himself, he argued that a Russian revolution would only survive if it was part of an international revolution. He claimed, "We are now in a besieged fortress waiting for the other detachments of the world socialist revolution to come to our relief." The conventional wisdom has it that this world revolution never materialized, and therefore Marx was wrong. But in fact, during the years following World War I, Marx's predictions came within a hair's breadth of succeeding. Even Britain, the center of European stability, was closer to revolution than at any time in this century. There were tanks on the streets of London, troops encircling Glasgow, where the red flag flew on the town hall. There were little Moscows in the Rhondda, strikes on the railways and in the mines, dockers refusing to load arms for the war against Soviet Russia, coupled with the threat of a general strike. In northern Italy, in Milan and Turin, the scenario was much as Marx had predicted. The international proletarians occupied the factories and took control of production by setting up workers' councils. The factory council is the model for the proletarian state, claimed their leader Gramsci. They armed themselves to defend their gains. It was a challenge that was only contained by the army and by Mussolini's black shirts. Berlin under the red flag, announced the headlines in 1919. In the unrest following World War I, the Kaiser was deposed and a republic formed under the powerful German Social Democrat Party, who were strongly influenced by Marxism. In January 1919, the Spartacist League, forerunner of the German Communist Party, led uprisings throughout Germany which came close to the revolution Marx had expected. Many soldiers and workers had been disillusioned and radicalized by the war. And in Bremen, Leipzig, Bavaria, and Hamburg, Soviet republics were set up. Spartacist leader Karl Liebknecht announced, "Whether or not we shall survive when all is achieved, our program will live. It will dominate the world of liberated peoples in spite of all." Because the German army was unreliable, this revolutionary crisis was only put down by a volunteer right-wing militia, the Free Corps, forerunner of Hitler's brown shirts. The Free Corps broke the back of the German workers' movement at the cost of thousands of lives. The leaders, among them Rosa Luxemburg, were murdered and dumped in the canals. In Hungary, the pattern was the same. The monarchy overthrown by a broad-based socialist government. Then the declaration of a Soviet republic. Isabella Kunze remarks, "Every step of actual movement is more important than a dozen grams." The Hungarian Soviet lasted 6 months and was undermined by the invasion of Czech and Romanian forces who occupied Budapest. Workers' councils like this one were executed. Marx's predictions of proletarian revolution in the advanced capitalist countries had been proved right. The proletariat looked for a time as though it would become the leading class of the 20th century. Where the Marxist movements went wrong was in misjudging the resilience of capitalism and the strength of the state. It was a costly mistake, and as the tide of revolution in Europe began to ebb, it left the Russian Revolution isolated and exposed. The Soviet Union stood isolated. It was encircled by Tsarist troops, backed by the armies of 17 nations. These were the soldiers, workers, and peasants who fought to hold back the combined forces of the capitalist countries in their crusade against what the British War Secretary, Winston Churchill, called the nameless beast of communism. For a time, it seemed likely that the first Marxist revolution would be defeated, like the other revolutions in Europe. But in an amazingly short space of time, the Bolsheviks shaped a red army from an undisciplined, backward peasantry. Its organizer was the war commissar, Trotsky. This army took on a vastly superior force, and against all expectations, they won. The Soviet Revolution survived, but at appalling cost. Russia's backward and underdeveloped industry lay in ruins, devastated by the war. 9 million people had died in the war from famine, cold, and disease. Now to the immense problems of this vast, semi-feudal, backward nation were added the burden of millions of refugees. There was also sabotage by opponents of the Bolsheviks, and even armed rebellion from among their supporters. Lenin faced these colossal problems by establishing, in his own words, strict iron discipline backed up by the state power of the armed workers. And Lenin's centralized Bolshevik party structure became the instrument of this discipline. He had set in motion the state machine that Stalin would inherit. Opposition was banned and the secret police began the searches, arrests and executions. Rosa Luxemburg had written, "The remedy which Trotsky and Lenin have found, the elimination of democracy as such, is worse than the disease it is supposed to cure, for it stops up the very living source from which alone can come the correction of all the innate shortcomings of social institutions. That source is the active, untrammeled, energetic, political life of the broadest masses of the people." Her words were tragically borne out in the trials and executions of Mensheviks and social revolutionaries. Lenin's party of iron became increasingly centralized, bureaucratic and dictatorial. Worst of all, Red Terror failed to solve Russia's economic problems. Lenin was forced to relax the rigors of war communism and adopt a new economic policy of limited private enterprise. The new policy worked. The peasants provided food for the cities and industrial production began again. The new socialist society began to tackle the aftermath of the war. To feed and clothe the millions of orphans. To provide free education and to raise the cultural level of the Russian population. To produce a new generation of human beings, tough, clean, disciplined, hard-working. To break the hold of religious superstition. And to construct a modern industrial society. In spite of everything, the Soviet Revolution did move forward. In spite of everything, there was a sense of optimism, of the novelty and boldness of the Soviet experiment. There was a sense of modernism, of new openings towards the future. People were becoming aware of themselves as agents in a process of revolutionary change. Lenin died in 1924. There was genuine popular grief. Almost at once, the construction of the Lenin myth began, part of which is that Lenin had no responsibility for the excesses that were to follow. Stalin was waiting in the wings. Already General Secretary under Lenin, Stalin was an ambitious careerist who had made his way up the party hierarchy. He took control of the funeral arrangements and mummified Lenin like a pharaoh. Lenin had built the Soviet party machine that Stalin was to control. Towards the end of his life, he had sensed the possible consequences. But Lenin's warnings were ignored. Thank you. Throughout the 20s and 30s, Stalin consolidated his control. He began to build his own frozen version of socialism, a society of neat lives and optimistic souls with no room for questioning or debate. Stalin was determined to drag Russia out of backwardness. Either we do it or they crush us, he claimed. He set about mechanizing and collectivizing the mass of peasants. His aim was to use agriculture to supply the surplus for rapid industrialization. And to achieve this, Stalin decided to eliminate the wealthier peasants as a class. About 5 million people were deported and 2 million died. For Stalin, this was only a beginning. He jailed or executed millions of people in the party, the army, and the bureaucracy. This was Stalin's contribution to the fulfillment of the Communist Manifesto. Stalin had done more to destroy the hope of socialism than all its enemies put together. And yet, at the price of terror, Stalin modernized the Soviet economy. And under Stalin, Marxism became the religion of Russia's national development. The foundations of modern industry were laid. He announced, "We are becoming a country of metal, a country of automobiles, a country of tractors." And following Lenin, he claimed, "The party plus electrification equals communism."
В настоящий момент мы даем 3,500 смену вам. Это много. Но комсомолия ставит своей задачей догнать и перегнать Америку, дать смену 7000 ламп. Этого мы добьемся. Мы настолько овладели техникой, что выпустили свою техническую книгу под названием «Как делается электролампочка». Читайте ее. А работу бригады вы увидите сейчас.
The central planning of the Soviet economy spawned a massive bureaucracy. 6 million even under Lenin, now it had become a self-perpetuating elite. The bureaucracy was charged with producing the epic monuments to Stalin's era. At a time during the 1930s when the capitalist world was gripped by recession and the growth of fascism, the images of Soviet modernization, education and welfare appealed to many in the West as an attractive alternative. With his rich sense of humor, Stalin claimed, "Of all the treasures a state can possess, the human lives of its citizens are for us the most precious." Soviet citizens were required to express their unanimous consent for Stalin's rule through the ballot box. In the one-party state, who can guess which party Stalin voted for?
Hello, this is Moscow calling from the...
It was this deformed model of Marxism that was exported to communist parties around the world.
Workers of the world, unite! Шагайте, на битву шагайте, шагайте, шагайте. Проверьте прицел, заряжайте ружье. На бой, пролетарий, за дело свое. На бой, пролетарий, за дело свое.
In 1939, Stalinism, the deformity of socialism, confronted fascism, the deformity of capitalism. As in the First World War, Russia faced Germany. But this time, Stalin's newly industrialized Soviet Union was finally victorious. the war cost 20 million Russian lives, and confirmed Stalin as a world figure alongside Roosevelt and Churchill. The nameless beast of communism carved up post-war Europe with a man who had organized the war of intervention. The Soviet Union was now a world power. As the Soviet Union began to rebuild its industrial base shattered by the war, Stalinism congealed into a new system of exploitation. Like capitalism, there were the old divisions between manual and mental labor. Like capitalism, workers still labored for wages and incentives. And like capitalism, a surplus was extracted from their labor. But the property-owning capitalist class had been replaced by a privileged administrative class who controlled and disposed of the surplus because they were effectively in command of the state. The cement that held this system in place was a sentimental rewriting of the origins of the so-called workers' state in the heroism of the October Revolution. Its bland optimism and moral piety would almost certainly have been despised by both Marx and Lenin. This mythology was used to legitimize Stalin's caricature of socialism and to affirm him in command, the benign father of his people. In the aftermath of the war, it was this version of socialism that was imposed on Eastern Europe by conquest. It was sealed behind defensive ramparts, fortress socialism confronting fortress capitalism, each system feeding off the other and providing justification for a mutual military build-up.
Can you make out any rank in the tower?
I think the one on the right is a lance corporal. And the one on the left is either a junior sergeant or a sergeant. I think it's a sergeant.
Socialism came to Eastern Europe not as Marx had foreseen by popular uprising, but by military force. This was Stalin's version of internationalism, and this force was as much to hold people down under socialism as to raise them up. It was a force that brought the Baltic states into the Soviet Union and brought communism to Bulgaria, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, Poland, Romania, East Germany. Only Yugoslavia escaped to build its own radical brand of decentralized socialism. But despite the reassurance of the Red Army, these regimes have never been wholly secure. In Czechoslovakia, 40% of the population had voted for communism in the post-war elections. But in May 1968, after 2 decades of Stalinism, the Communist Party itself under Dubček tried to create socialism out of Stalinism.
It is a true, real new spring in our country. Everyone feels it, and everyone wishes it.
We want to see a truly democratic socialism.
We don't want to restore capitalism, we don't want to restore private ownership. That's clear, we just want to continue in socializing the whole society and narrowing the gap between the theories about socialism and the practice in Czechoslovakia.
The Communist Party abandoned its control of information through censorship. The free flow of information must have come as a profound shock after 2 decades of silence. It opened eyes and opened mouths, stimulating criticism and debate. The truth about the system could finally be acknowledged. The leadership even relaxed its monopoly of power, claiming, "The party cannot impose its authority. This has to be won again and again by party activity." But for the Soviet Union, as Marx would have put it, the force of argument was countered by the argument of force. Warsaw Pact tanks invaded Czechoslovakia to be met with popular defiance. The same tanks had crushed the East German general strike of 1953 and the workers' councils of the Hungarian uprising of 1956. Soviet soldiers, who had been told that they had come to save Czechoslovakia from CIA-backed counter-revolution, were faced with the non-violent protests of the mass of the Czech people. The Soviet tank crews were besieged, not by capitalist stooges, but by Czech socialists, arguing their position and demanding Russia's departure. On the walls of Prague appeared a single word in Russian. Why? The day after the invasion, under the noses of the Russians, 1,200 Czech communists met secretly in a factory to oppose the Soviet invasion. Delegate after delegate, many of whom had been party officials under the Stalinist regime of Novotny, denounced the Russians and called for their withdrawal.
Communist Party is strongly against occupation. It means against Russians. I think it's only one who organize everything against occupants. I think it's Communist Party, it's Czech Communist Party. Maybe you are surprised about this fact, but it's reality.
It took 18 months before control was finally re-established. Dubček's supporters were jailed or demoted, the reforms dismantled. For the masses, Western-style consumerism was offered to pacify opposition. But in Czechoslovakia, as in Poland, a cumbersome, top-heavy political system found this hard to deliver. In Poland, the monument proudly proclaims Leninism, the triumphant banner of our epoch. The Leninist version of Marxism received a rude shock when in 1980 a genuine trade union movement emerged from a series of bitter strikes throughout Poland. It's common to recognize in solidarity the Catholic and nationalist opposition to Polish communism. But solidarity was a profound threat, above all, because it gained the support of three-quarters of the Polish working class, even in the communist power base of the Silesian coalfields.
Te wszystkie sprawy tak nabrzmiały, niezadowolenie ogólne, rozgoryczenie tymi rządami, przecieki różne, że jednak wiedzieliśmy pewne sprawy, które panowie nasi mają załatwione polubownie, lżej, lepiej, a my musimy tylko od nas wymagano pracy, pracy, pracy.
It was the renewal of class struggle between the workers and their so-called workers' state which made solidarity such a powerful challenge. They proposed basic changes, echoing the Paris Commune, for genuine work-based democracy. They backed up their demands with the organized industrial power of the strike.
Oni bimbają sobie z nas, panie. Z naszych, panie, petycji, naszego wszystkiego. Mamy doświadczenie, że górnicy niech się nie wyłamują, panie, bo w 70 roku się wyłamali raz, w Gdańsku się krew lała naszych robotników, naszych braci, a górnicy poszli w niedzielę federowali. Ja się wstydziłem za nich, że sam górnikiem byłem. Wstydziłem się.
The thrust of Solidarity's working-class popular democracy would have been as unwelcome in the capitalist West as it was to the Polish state.
Wielki jest ciężar odpowiedzialności, jaka spada na mnie w tym dramatycznym momencie polskiej historii. Obowiązkiem moim jest wziąć tę odpowiedzialność. Chodzi o przyszłość Polski.
During the suppression of the East German uprising of 1953, the communist poet Bertolt Brecht had suggested, helpfully, that if the government had lost confidence in the people, perhaps it should dissolve the people and elect another one. Today, it seems as if the Polish state would like to bury Solidarity and elect another, more compliant working class. In the catalogue of repression in Poland, Hungary, Czechoslovakia, East Germany and so on, many would see the stifling of hope.
But alongside the very real repression, Marxists would point out that every uprising in Eastern Europe also brings nearer the socialist challenge to Soviet-style communism, because the forces of class struggle that produced them refused to disappear. The old mole of revolution, as Marx put it, is still at work. Or to put it another way, though the Marxists in the Kremlin may have finished with Marx, Marx is not finished with them.